Good morning. If there's anybody in the reception area, please come in. Right. We are ready to get started. Seymour, seat, find a seat. I hope you can find a seat. Is there an empty seat somewhere? Two seats? Right over here. Oh, okay, Seymour. And Ollie, there's a few seats at this table up in the front. Table number, what is it? Three. Okay, I think I will begin, not to take time away from our speaker. I am Sylvia Kaufman, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to today's conference, Islam Beyond the Headlines. We hope you enjoy your day. A very warm welcome to our distinguished speaker, Professor Omid Safi. We are grateful and honored that you are the first Muslim speaker at a consortium conference. It's wonderful to be back at Calvin. We were here for our first conference in 2001, then again in 2005, and now here we are again. And I'd like to give a very special thank you to Franz van Lira, our Calvin committee member on the consortium. Your gracious hospitality, your planning and implementing of these conferences have made them all a success. Also thank Doug Kinsey, director of the Kauffman Institute at Grand Valley. Doug, not only for your personal involvement in this conference and administrative support, but for your excellent leadership as director of the Kauffman Institute. And we thank Heidi Stuckia in Doug's office for her administrative support, our breakout session speakers who are probably with us, and our Calvin student helpers. This is the seventh conference presented by the West Michigan Academic Consortium, now in collaboration with the Kauffman Interfaith Institute. Our mission is to provide programming that leads to greater interfaith understanding and mutual acceptance. We now have 8 participating schools. Both Cornerstone University and Kuiper College have joined us since the last conference. The commitment of the Consortium Steering Committee to our mission and to bringing outstanding scholars to West Michigan has been marvelous, and it truly is an illustration of the value of collaboration. I would like to introduce you and recognize the members of the Consortium Steering Committee, and we save your applause. We'll applaud them at the end. Would you please stand, those of you who are here? From Aquinas College, Stephen Davis. From Calvin College, Franz van Lira. From Calvin Theological Seminary, Carl Bosma. From Cornerstone University, John Duff. From Grand Valley, Doug Kinsey and Stephen Rao. From Hope College, Barry Banstra. And from Kuiper College, Mel Flickman. And finally, from Western Theological Seminary, Chris Kaiser. And I would like to add that next year's conference will be hosted by Western Seminary in Holland. You all have an evaluation form. Oh, that's a plug. You have an evaluation form in your program. We really value your feedback, so please fill it out before you leave after the last session that you attend, and leave it at the registration desk. And for students, we welcome you, but we really would like you to identify yourself on the evaluation form as a student, if you are one. And if you're not on our mailing list and would like to be, please do that at the registration table. And now I invite Franz van Lira to introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Sylvia, for those kind words. And Sylvia, I think you really owe the greatest applause of all of us for the initiative. As Sylvia said, my name is Franz van Lira. I represent Calvin College on the Western Michigan Consortium. When we first conceived of the topic for today's conference, we could not fathom what a timely topic this would be. Since we conceived of the topic, a proposed Islamic center at Ground Zero and a certain pastor in Florida who shares very unfortunate a name with one of the members of the Monty Python team. All these have made great headlines. And today we want to talk about Islam beyond the headlines. As Sylvia said, it is almost 10 years ago that Sylvia initiated the West Michigan Academic Consortium, which led to the first of these conferences here at Calvin College. Now, the West Michigan Consortium is a cooperation of many different schools, many of them Christian colleges, and I'm very glad that two more Christian colleges recently joined us. Interfaith dialogue can sometimes be a contested issue at Christian colleges. The question is, interfaith dialogue, how do we do this? And especially, how do we do it well? For me, personally, inspiration comes from the prophetic tradition that Judaism, Christianity, and Islam all share. In the prophet Micah, we read, "This is what the Lord requires of you, to act justly, love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God." Well, we act justly when we give a voice to our neighbor and treat him with kindness. And humility, if you will forgive me going into the Middle Ages, which is really my topic, humility was defined by the 12th century Christian monk Hugh of St. Victor as the willingness to learn at all times from every one of God's creatures. Well, it is in this spirit that I want to extend a very warm welcome to Omid Safi. Omid Safi is professor of religious studies at UNC Chapel Hill. And before that, he taught at Colgate University for 7 years, where he was nominated Professor of the Year for every year he was there. He is the author of the books Muhammad, Memories of Muhammad, Why the Prophet Matters, and editor of Progressive Muslims on Justice, Gender, and Pluralism. Both of these books are available at our book table. He earned a PhD in religion from Duke University, and he was a student of Vincent Cornell, who was here a couple of years ago, and who also recommended him as a speaker to this committee, saying that his student Omid was much smarter and better than him. In the aftermath of 9/11, Omid Safi has given over 400 talks and interviews on the topic of Islam in America. He also has time to be married and have 4 children at the same time. It is a great honor and a pleasure to welcome Omid Safi as our plenary speaker.
Well, good morning, friends. I have a rather trite and boring of beginning each and every single public talk that I give. And it consists of thanking people for the gift of their time. And it may sound like a cliche and a truism, but it actually comes out of one of the deeper parts of the Islamic tradition. And it's a simple teaching, really. It's a recognition that in our lifetime, the number of breaths that we get to take are maktub, which is written. We have a certain number of moments that we get to have in our lifetime, and there's nothing that a person can do to add a single breath or to subtract one from what God has intended for us. When you are a speaker that gets invited and hosted in such a generous and hospitable way, which goes to show you that, contrary to what people say, Middle Easterners and Muslims do not have a monopoly on hospitality, but it happens to be just like love and charity, beauty, kindness, and let's be honest, stupidity, ignorance, hatred, evil, that these are human traits that run through each and every single one of us. And the great struggle to be a child of God is a struggle that is taking place not between civilizations, not between nations, but it's actually a daily struggle for each and every one of us. When you're a speaker who gets invited and gets asked to speak on topics that are so dear and near to so many of our hearts, the responsibility that I feel is to remain mindful of the fact that I've been asked to take an hour or two of the moments of your life. So what is it that we can accomplish in this next hour or two together so that you and I, we would come away from this time richer, inshallah, as we say, for this time together? That is the goal and the destination. And with that, we begin. When I think about the situation of Islam and Muslims, and I also think about our American society, let's be honest about where we are. We are living in difficult days. These are times that are hard, and they are hard at almost every single level and layer of what makes us human. I'm going to try to end up in a place that's hopeful and inspiring, but I do not want that to come at the expense of a realistic look at where we are. We, as an American society, are having a hard time these days. And the hard time takes place at many different levels. For a lot of us, it's economic. No one exactly knows for sure, but there's probably 40 million plus of us that do not have health insurance. This is not a luxury. I know a lot of people in this audience probably have issues with their health. Those hundreds of talks that I've been asked to give over the course of the last decade are stressful. Having to answer the same questions about can you be truly Muslim and truly American at the same time are stressful. And at some point in 2009, at the ripe old age of 38, I had a heart attack. Ended up in the hospital with a blood pressure of 220 over 140, which was not fun when you have four children and a beautiful wife that you're also feeling responsible for. When I got the bill from the hospital, I said two things, only one of which can be sort of repeated here. And the first one was, good Lord. And the second one was not nearly as nice. There's a lot of us who are struggling. In my state of North Carolina, 10% of the population is actively looking for jobs and not able to find one. Right? That's not counting the ones that have given up looking for jobs. Right? I know in some parts of the country, like this area, that people have also been hit very hard. But it's not just economic and financial. the hardship that we're facing is also cutting right to the heart of what kind of an American society do we wish to have? What do we want our community to look like? And because of the fact, and this is something that I'm going to keep coming back to during the course of the talk, that we are now seeing, and I'm going to use a word that will make some people uncomfortable, but it is what we are. We are seeing the crumbling of an American empire. We have become, over the course of the last 50, 60, probably longer than that, years, a global empire with military bases in 150 countries. There's no other country on the planet that has lived like that. We have become the most heavily militarized society on the planet at a time where our schools are failing, our roads have potholes, our teachers are underpaid, and we don't have health insurance. Sylvia very gently last night said, "Don't be too political." I'm not. I don't care who you vote for in the next midterm election. Well, I do, but I'm not going to spend tonight talking about who you should vote for in the next midterm election. But, you know. But here's what I'm going to say. I'm not going to talk about what candidate or what party you or I should vote for. But if we are gathered as people of faith and people who are committed to interfaith dialogue, and not just dialogue, but action, how on God's earth can we claim to care about God and love God and not be inspired to rise up and act up for God's children? There's a fundamental disconnect. A faith that is only about God and doesn't extend passionate concern for God's children is opium. And we are past the point of making ourselves feel better. When I think about some of the events that Franz mentioned, when I think about the fact that much of the news in this country in the months of August and September was dominated by two headlines. The Ground Zero Mosque, which, as I like to say, is not a mosque, and it's not at Ground Zero. It's an Islamic cultural center that's going to have an interfaith center, yes, a prayer room, a swimming pool. I mean, this is not your Taliban version of Islam. Right? If people are wearing swimsuits, you don't have to be too scared of what they're going to do there. There's going to be banquets and places where people get married and they have discussions and meetings and what have you. And it's, to quote the great American Jewish philosopher John Stuart, on the hallowed grounds of the Burlington Coat Factory. Two blocks away from where 19 murderous, hateful people murdered close to 3,000 of us, Muslims and non-Muslims included, in that 3,000. Right? Within that two-block radius of Ground Zero, you're going to find a Burger King, a Dunkin' Donut, a couple of churches, a few Irish pubs. I'm told one of them is really nice, I wouldn't know. A gentleman's club, which, P.S., that doesn't make you a gentleman. It just makes you somebody who likes to look at nudie women. And people who say fake Rolexes. All of that takes place within a two-block radius of Lower Manhattan. Right? It's New York. It's America. And yet, people are flipping out over it. And then we have a pastor with suspect theology and a dwindling congregation of 50 people who hasn't paid his rent, who desperately wanted a podium. And the international news media ran to him and his hateful agenda of desecrating the most sacred object for Muslims, which is the Quran. I have a lot of friends in the media, and I've learned that just like all Muslims and all Jews and all Christians don't want to be treated as a monolith, we're not all one, that one should not treat all members of the media as a bloc. It's actually made up of people with their own opinions and views. And so at some point I was talking to my friends. I'm going to put aside Fox News because it's really like a reality TV show. There's no news content there. But I was talking to people in CNN, New York Times, MSNBC, and I was like, why are you doing this? You're hurting us. You're hurting our potential to actually be a nation worthy of our lofty ideals. And I said some bad words too. And they said, look, we didn't want to cover him. Other than his bad theology, the only reason to put him on camera is that he's got a really wicked mustache. But there's a lot of people that have wicked mustaches and they don't end up on TV. Until he said he was going to burn the Quran, Muslims got really upset and they started having demonstrations in Indonesia. General Petraeus got upset. Then President Obama said something. Oh. And then, before you know it, we have an international news story. So we have to cover it. Part of my concern is, why do we insist on giving a platform to hateful idiots? Why do we amplify ugly voices instead of shining the light on the places where goodness is present? And I'm here to tell you that for every hateful idiot from any one of our communities, there are 100 people who are doing extraordinary work in the Muslim community, in the Jewish community, in the Christian community, in agnostic and atheistic circles. People are doing good work without having it be recognized. We have one idiotic pastor who wants to burn the Quran. There are hundreds and hundreds of ministers and priests and rabbis that leading up to 9/11 were including readings from the Torah, from the Gospels, and from the Quran in front of their congregations. Part of the question for us is, why is it that we want to overlook the good and keep the focus on the evil, on the hateful? This is not to overlook ugliness. One of the things that we know is that this world is a stage of struggle between good and evil. That beauty and ugliness both exist, that light and darkness exist. But as a person of faith, one of the items that we're asked to have faith in is faith in the things unseen. Right? Those of you who are familiar with the Muslim scriptures would know that the opening chapter of the Quran is the Fatiha. And after the opening chapter of the Quran, one of the signs that we're given is that the faithful are those that have faith in the things unseen. Faith in the things unseen. We continue to hold on to the notion that there's goodness and faith in this world, that people are inspired to do good because of their faith, and that a better day is possible for all of God's children, even if it may not be in our lifetime. Franz mentioned that I'm married and I have 4 children. This is true. This is my single most important commitment in my life. I want to help bring about a world in which my children's and your children's well-being and dignity is not up for assault. I want to see a world in which my beautiful 10-year-old daughter, she is a mutt, who is of Iranian, Arab, Turkish, Kurdish, Irish, French-Canadian, German, and Dutch background.
Thank you.
And you know what that makes her? Beautiful. Beautiful. She's got perfect French-Canadian Irish features, beautiful almond Persian eyes, and brown hair down to here to die for. It's like the genetic experiment of a mad scientist. My son has big, round Persian eyes, brown, and dusty blonde hair. Right? Nobody in the world looks like him. Golden tan skin that he like tans like 5 minutes in the summertime. My wife, if she steps outside, she gets skin cancer like in 30 seconds. That's not funny, but. My children come home and we live like in the liberal bubble.
Right.
We live in one of the parts of country that prides itself on being snobby and elitist and educated. And in that community, my children come home and say, Baba, why do people say that your daddy's a terrorist? And my daughter's 10. She's 10. What do you say to something like that? I have a stepson who's 17 years old. He's 6'2", 220 pounds, big kid, a good kid. He's on the ultimate frisbee team at his school.
Is there the lap mic that I could wear instead of this by chance?
Sure. My stepson, who is the world's first successful human cloning subject, he's a carbon copy of my wife, who is the Irish, German, French, Canadian, Dutch product. So he's a freckled face, blonde, red, blue-eyed kid, 6'2", 220, who's Muslim, but doesn't look like what you would think Muslims look like. Which means that when he's in high school, he gets to hear what everybody says about Muslims. Because when I'm around, people know that I know a little bit and I don't put up with crap. I don't give people permission to speak ill of entire groups. African Americans, Jews, blacks, gays, Hispanics, Muslims, whatever. It's unacceptable. And we have to give each other permission to make certain kinds of inappropriate jokes, right? And I simply refuse to grant that permission. If somebody's like, I met one day, I heard the Jews did this, I'm like, you know what? I don't find that amusing, period. And the next time, they won't bring that kind of comment. My son doesn't arouse that kind of suspicion in people, so they make all kinds of jokes about him. But sometimes they deal with it the way that teenagers do. So he's on an ultimate frisbee team, and nobody's called by their name. If you're familiar with teenagers, everybody's like, you know, fatty and fat ass and, you know, dumbbell and kind of whatever. So I'm watching my son play frisbee, and this kid tosses the frisbee. And he's like, go get a terrorist, go, go terrorist, go! my son's nickname among his friends is the terrorist. I started to get really concerned until I realized that this mutual insult society, it just goes all the way around. So one of his best friends at school is David Rosenfeld. Jacob tosses the frisbee and goes, "Go get it, Jew! Run faster, Jew! Go get it!" And then I realized that everyone has some kind of derogatory name like that. And it's funny when it's teenagers, it's not so funny when it's acted out in our society. So when we're having a conversation about the Park 51 complex, and the discussion is, did people obtain that piece of land legally? Yes, they did. They bought it legally. Do they have the constitutional right to build a religious building the same way that Jews and Christians have had? Absolutely. So what else is the issue? If the issue is that 1.5 billion Muslims around the world should continue to feel shame for something that 19 terrorists did, then that's tantamount to collective punishment. I've done enough bad things in my own lifetime, and I will take responsibility for the good and the bad that I'm responsible for. And one of my understandings is, in the day of judgment, that God will hold me responsible. I'm not responsible for you. I'm not responsible for what other people who share my hair color, my eye color, my ethnicity, or my religion do. If I am responsible at some level, it's as a human. I believe that we're not isolated bubbles that are going through this life as islands, but as children of God that have a collective responsibility. And I do think God's going to hold us accountable. So here's the heart of what I want to get to for today. We live in a pretty messed up world. We live in a world in which there is a disparity between the haves and the have-nots. That's not new. Somewhere I remember a certain person that you and I are both very fond of saying, "And the poor shall always be with you." It's not that poverty is new. It's that the gap between the super haves and the ultra have-nots has never been greater. We've done amazing things on this planet, and I'm very proud of a lot of it. We have great cars, nice cameras, nice roads. I've got this little toy that I'm kind of addicted to, my little phone here.
I can send text messages and emails
and pictures and cool stuff like that to have friends around the world. But one out of every 5 of God's children is living on $1 a day. 1 out of every 5 people. 1 out of every 5 people lives without access to clean water or adequate food. That's unacceptable. And it's unacceptable not just because it creates a political problem, and it's unacceptable not just because it's an economic crisis. Morally, it's repugnant. And as people of faith, I do believe that in the hereafter, God will hold us accountable. I put you on earth, and I gave you the ability to have enough wheat and food to feed everyone. And you made different choices. Being a person of faith, I've been fortunate to learn something from people of different traditions. I've been fortunate in my life to have learned something from my Jewish friends, particularly many of whom come from the perspective of Jewish mysticism that takes the responsibility of Tikkun Olam seriously, to heal the world. That we are intended to be united, and we have become fractured, and this healing of the world is a moral and religious mitzvah. I learned something from some of my Christian friends. If my first and foremost teacher would be my mommy, and the second one my dad, and the third one the prophet, probably the fourth one would be Martin Luther King. He's as influential of a presence in my own life as any. When I go to my son's high school to talk these days, it's usually not to talk about Islam. It's actually to talk about how do we get past the point of minimizing the evil that religion can do. And at some point, I want us to have the audacity to believe that religion can be more than simply not bad. That we have the responsibility to do more than quarantine the damage and the evil that can be and has been done in all of our traditions. And all of us can just take 10 seconds, look inside, think about whether it's extremism, terrorism, sexual scandals, rampant nationalism, occupation, stuff that goes on in Ashram. Whatever tradition you come from, you can look inside and you can think about scandals that have taken place inside our own tradition. But I want us to keep believing that religion can actually be a force, a public force for good, for justice, for the uplifting of God's children. And I oftentimes end up going back to Martin Luther King. Schools seem to get a kick out of inviting a Muslim speaker to talk about Dr. King. I don't know, and you know, it's kind of embarrassing at some point. They're like, and he's the first Muslim. I'm like, okay, I get it. I'm the first Muslim speaker, like, ever. I'm the first funny Muslim speaker. I'm the first sarcastic Muslim speaker. I'm the first Muslim speaker to talk about Dr. King. Can I get out of the Jackie Robinson box and just talk first? I don't play baseball. I can't dunk a basketball either. 5'7" and in Iran. So, and I talk to these high school students who are bored to tears with Dr. King, or as my son calls him, this is 17-year-old sarcasm, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, comma, Junior, period. And this hurts. Because Martin, I talk to Martin, car rides, and I'm like, Martin, I know you were crying over that cup of coffee when people called you and called you names. How did you respond? You know, we have these conversations, and hopefully they don't lock me up for that. And I realized at some point the reason that my son's high school, and he's not alone, is bored to tears with Martin is that Martin has become an icon. He has become a non-human black Jesus who is so elevated above the level of being a genuine prophet that he no longer poses a challenge to us. What do prophets do? What does it mean if we say Prophet Muhammad or the prophetic tradition that Franz spoke of? Look, in the Bible and in the Quran, the prophets never come to a community and say, steady as she goes. You're doing great, super job on the poor and the orphans. God loves you. Don't change a thing. Hooray, status quo. No. The prophets come to people and say, repent now, for the judgment of the Lord is upon thee. Prophets are challenging. Prophets remind us of what's ugly in our own selves and in our own community. Prophets remind us that repentance is necessary, not only at an individual level, but at a societal level. And when we're lucky enough to have a genuine prophet, I'm not talking about a prophet in the Muslim term, but in the Christian term, just for the Muslims in the audience, don't freak out. I'm not calling Martin Luther King a prophet after Muhammad, okay? I'm speaking in an American civil language kind of a tradition. You have to say these things, I learned. When you have a prophetic presence like Martin, you have one of two choices. You can either sit there and be challenged by him, or you can make him into a god, where 1 month, 1 week, 1 day out of the year, you go and you pay your respects, and then you go back to business as usual, where every president will show up at his gravesite, place a wreath, and then go back to continuing the war that is sucking not only our finances, but the very best of our young people. And I asked the young people in my son's high school and the faith communities that I go to speak to, and say, how many of you have listened or watched Martin's I Have a Dream speech? So let me just get a show. How many of you have seen I Have a Dream speech? It's hardly a person that hasn't. And then I asked that same high school audience, how many of you have ever listened or read Martin's Riverside Church speech? And you get maybe 5% of hands that go up. Why is that? Because I Have a Dream is a safe speech today. It wasn't safe in 63. But it's the message of racial equality and civil rights, and you should be judged by the content of your character, not the color of your skin. Good, fine, check, check, check. But a Martin who shows up April 4th, 1967, and says, I have come to this magnificent house of worship because my conscience no longer allows me to remain silent. A time comes where silence is betrayal, and for us, that time is now. A Martin that says, I have come to see a connection between the poverty in my society and a war halfway around the world. A Martin that says, a society has a soul, and I believe that the soul of America is sick, but the soul of America is dying, and we are struggling with a triplet giant evil: racism, materialism, and what is the third one?
Militarism.
Now, if that was true in 1967, it's true today. We have spent more on the military than the next 50 countries combined. How many times do we need to blow up the Earth before we say we're safe enough? 3,000 times, is that enough? I mean, wouldn't 17 do? Right, even cockroaches and Twinkie bars wouldn't survive our destructive power. And then at some point we're gonna say, we have enough power to blow it up 17 times. Let's use the rest to feed the poor, to build schools. Right? And look, you can think about it from the perspective that I would urge us to think about, which is to say, let's take it seriously when in Genesis, God said, let us create humanity in our image. Let's take it seriously that says, if we as Muslims are going to be offended when an idiotic pastor wants to burn the Quran, and we should be offended if someone wants to burn the Bible or the Torah, let us be equally offended when there's a child who goes hungry, because that child too is divine scripture. Because the presence of God is present in that child every bit as much, if not more so, than black ink on a white piece of paper is. And every time that there's a bomb that is dropped, or there's a suicide bomber that walks into a puddle and blows somebody up, those are walking, breathing scriptures that are destroyed. think about friends of mine who come from the Jewish tradition and the Muslim tradition relate to this very easily. What do you do with a manuscript of the Torah? If you're lucky enough to be in a place where you have one, how do you take care of it? Rabbi, you have one in your synagogue? How do you take care of it? As best you can. In a Muslim household, a copy of the Quran would never be put on the floor. It always stays on a shelf. In many Muslim cultures, it's wrapped up in a protective covering. You open it, before you open it, you kiss it, and you touch it here, and then you open it. It's kind of like the way you would treat a love letter from God. That's how God's children deserve to be treated. If we are told in the Quran, وَنَفَخْتُ مِن رُوحِ, God says, I breathe into the human something of my own spirit. If we're told in the Quran, سَنُرِيْهَ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهُمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ إِنَّهُ الْحَقِّ, we shall show them our signs in three places. In ayat, the scriptures, on the farthest horizons, i.e. the natural realm, nature is also God's grand scripture, وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, and inside your own souls, until it becomes clear to you that God is truth. Look for God in scripture, look for God in nature, and look for God inside the souls of humanity. It's to take that responsibility seriously. These days, it doesn't take a whole heck of a lot to have someone get up and say, I'm disappointed in what American society has become. You just have to watch
Leading Heart Liberal TV program.
And it doesn't take a whole lot to have someone say, and I'm disappointed in what Islam has become. You can just watch Fox News any day of the week. And they have a whole barrage of brown people who are happy to come on and tell you how terrible Islam is. As somebody who is Muslim and is American, I want to tell you that it's okay to be disappointed, but only if your disappointment is connected to a deeper love. The only genuine reform of a society, of a community, or of a religion can come from people who are deeply rooted in that community, in that tradition, and sustained by a sense of love. Otherwise, it's a self-hating, self-loathing kind of a process. We already agreed and decided that Muslims shouldn't have a monopoly on hospitality, right? But being an Iranian, shaming people and honoring people is something that's almost genetic, right? Every Iranian needs some therapy at some point. Iranians and Jews have a lot in common about this. And if you're an Iranian Jew, I don't know what to tell you. You need therapy and medication. But I'm here to tell you that being ashamed of what is done in the name of your religion, or being ashamed of what your country has become, is not licensed to reform it. Because one of the fundamental teaching points of the Islamic tradition is this: God has breathed into us something of His Spirit. The presence of the Lord dwells within us. And there are divine qualities, to use Islamic language, Asma al-Husna, the lovely names of God, that are there as potentialities inside us. If God is merciful, we too can aspire to be merciful. If God is just, we should aspire to be just. There's not a single divine name that is the shameful, the one that makes you feel like crap, the ones that uses guilt trips. But there is a divine name that is Al-Wadud, the loving. one of the things that I look for people who want to see themselves as would-be reformers of America or of a particular religious tradition is, are you inspired by a sense of love? How deep is your love? That song from a while ago. And whom are you serving? Is it talk, or do I see action to actually uplift God's children? Part of my hope in all of this has been the simple notion that we all can be a part of restoring a sense of loveliness to our tradition and to our nation. It's a messed up nation, and it's a messed up tradition that a lot of us inherit at this time. Messed up, not because all of it is messed up, but because there are elements in it that need to be addressed. The question is, who will undertake the reform, and under what criteria, what guidance? That creating of what in the American context we would call a more perfect union, and let's be honest, the more perfect union is not in our past. It has to be in our future. It is not at the time of the founding fathers. Because women, you know what you didn't have back then, and they had slaves. And I'm sorry, but if you have slaves, it's not a more perfect union for all of us. A more perfect union is something to aspire to. Right? What's one of the last talks that Martin Luther King gives? He speaks of the Christian era as something that begins when? Hasn't begun. The Christian era, for Martin, is something in our future. And that's the same message that I hear from a lot of Muslim reformers. Everybody and their grandmother is talking about Islamic reform, Islamic ethics. But the genuine Muslim society, a society in which we would treat one another the way that the Prophet treated those around him, is something for us not to inherit from the past, but to work to build the future. And that takes a lot of work. In the books that are out there, I've tried to identify some of the ways in which this kind of a process can work. Time is short, the moments of your life are precious, and I would rather have a lot of time for question and answers. I'll say a few things and then open it up for your comments. I think the talk title that Sylvia and I had come up with was Where's the Justice, Where's the Love? And we've talked about justice, and I want to just say a few words about love as well. When you read Martin is kind. So when he has a criticism, you know that he means it. One of the few people that consistently criticizes is Nietzsche. Not because of the God is dead bumper sticker, but because Nietzsche misunderstood love. He understood love to be sentimentality. And Martin says, I'm not speaking of that kind of love. I'm speaking of a strong and demanding kind of love. As a Muslim, when we think about love, one begins with the Quran. You begin with the fact that we have 114 chapters. 113 of them begin with this phrase, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the name of God, full of love, compassion, and grace. Having children teaches you a little bit. You think you're there to teach them, they teach you a thing or two. My same 17-year-old, sarcastic, 6'2", freckle-faced, blonde, blue-eyed kid, Jacob, one day we were reading, and I'm like, well, Jacob, what does Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim mean? And he goes sarcastically, in the name of God, most merciful, most compassionate. I was like, that's not nice, but what? And he's like, oh, merciful and compassionate. I'm 15. This doesn't mean anything to me. Oh, and that's a bad word. We got a lot of work to do, right? And so then I went back and I tried to figure out, what can I find in the Islamic tradition to make these words meaningful to my own son? My wife happened to be pregnant at that time. She's been pregnant a lot. I'm told I have something to do with that. And I read something from the great Muslim mystic Ibn Arabi, who came from Spain. This was the time before Muslims and Jews were kicked out of Spain. And he says that the words Rahman and Rahim, compassionate and merciful, actually come from the root Rahim, which means the womb of a woman. It is as if the entire cosmos is contained inside God's womb, and God is providing care, nurturing, love, nourishment, directly, organically, for every creature, the way that a pregnant mother does for her unborn child. And my son said, whoa. What's needed for us is not just translating our religious teachings from Arabic and Hebrew and Greek and Latin and Sanskrit into English. A lot of our religious teachings are articulated in a pre-modern and medieval worldview, which just doesn't sing for a lot of us. And I say this hurts me because I'm a medievalist. I spent years of my life studying those medieval languages, and I've got a library of 10,000 medieval books. I love me some medievals. It works for me, it doesn't work for a lot of our children. How do we update that language? Early on in Islamic teachings, people made a distinction between two kinds of love, haqiqi and majazi, allegorical love and real love. Allegorical love, they said, is the love that we all can share. Real love is the love for God. They said, human love is like when you learn the alphabet. You learn the alphabet so that you can master the language of loving God and being loved by God. But then around 1200s, there started to be this evolution in Islamic thought, particularly in the spiritual tradition, where people said, you know what, we're going to speak of, and Bob Marley would be proud here, one love. There is, in fact, one love. Anyone who loves purely selflessly to uplift the other one and to be cleansed by that love is placing herself within that channel of divine love. It is love that brought us here, and it is love that will deliver us back to God. That one love tradition, I believe, is one of the key components that today we have to wed together to direct social action. In December, if God gives me moments and breaths, I'm going to turn 4 years old. Not a kid, I've got four kids of my own. I'm gone bald, you know, I just have hair down here. When I look at a lot of my friends that started marching with me in the late 80s, and we marched against everything. Nuclear proliferation, the first Iraq war, the second Iraq war, the next Iraq war, so a bumper sticker, whatever the next war is, I'm already against it, right? And I look at a lot of my friends now, who are in their late 30s, early 40s, good, bleeding Heart, liberals, Birkenstock, granola, vegan, tree-hugging, virtually communist, all of that. They're some of the angriest people you've ever seen in your life. All you have to do is sneak up behind them and go, Bush. And they turn into rabid dogs, foaming at the mouth. The same kind-hearted liberal people, liar, cheater, deceiver, lied to us, killed thousands of our children, a million Iraqis. Cheney, just watch out. Fox News, Sean Hannity, Glenn Beck, right? And I think why? It's not that they're bad people. And it's not that they have ceased from social action. If you have a cell phone, and a lot of you do, you watch it 10 times every day to see if you run out of batteries. And if it starts to run low, you run to the plug. If you walk into a restaurant, you look for a booth that has a plug. You want to make sure your cell phone doesn't die. If you're driving a car and the yellow light comes on, you look for a gas station. You show that care for your cell phone, you show that care for your car, we don't show that care for our hearts and souls. We cannot give and give and give, do and do and do, without being replenished by that current of cosmic love that comes from God, enlivens our heart, and will take us back to God. And at the same time, when I speak of this love, I'm not talking about let's sit down in our house, turn the lights off, put on a candle, burn incense, and play some hippie new agey Enya music. I like Enya. I love candles. I don't mind incense. Right? Unless our spiritual quest is wed to direct social action to improve the lot of God's children, neither one of them can work and can work well. One of the nice things about this kind of a prophetic tradition is that we have a lot of resources for it within each of our traditions. We've been speaking about Tikkun Olam, we've talked about Martin. I'm going to give you a couple of examples from the Islamic tradition and then open it up for questions. Our Prophet Muhammad at one point says to his companions, come to the aid of your brother, whether he is oppressed or the oppressor. And the companions of the Prophet, I'm not a theologian, but my highly suspect theological reading is that Jesus' disciples and the Prophet's companions have one job, to make Jesus and Muhammad look good. They get to ask all the dumb questions so that Muhammad and Jesus can dispense with them. I don't know if theologically that holds water, but that's just what it seems like to me. So the companions say exactly as you would expect them to say, O messenger of God, may our lives be sacrificed for you. We understand why you would come to the aid of the one who's oppressed. But, O beloved of God, why would we help the one who's the oppressor? How do we help the oppressor? And the Prophet says, you come to the aid of the oppressor by stopping him. That there's actually a concern even for the salvation of the oppressor. And the way that you demonstrate that concern is by preventing him from oppressing God's children. There's a wonderful ethical treatise about 600 years after the time of the Prophet, written by a great Persian ethicist named Sa'di. It's a book called The Rose Garden. And the first chapter of it is about kings. Kings and presidents don't seem to have evolved very much in the last 1,000 years. They're drunken, fornicator tyrants, The king orders people's heads to be chopped off and then regrets it occasionally later on. He goes and he finds a mystic and he says, "Pray for me." There's a proud tradition of kings and presidents before they're about to go to war, asking ministers and rabbis and imams to bless them in the murderous action that they're about to undertake. And the king says to this mystic, Muslim mystic, "Pray for me." And the mystic says, "You wouldn't want me to." The king is like, "I am the king. I command you to pray for me." And the mystic says, "You really don't want me to." Things always happen in threes in Islamic stories. The king says, "Dang it, I'm the king and I command you to pray for me." And the mystic is like, "Fine, God, kill him." And the king goes, "What the hell kind of prayer was that?" And the mystic responds, and this is key, "By he in whose hand is my soul, this is best. It liberates people from your tyranny, and it prevents you from accumulating sins." The king says, "Okay." Next day, he goes to another mystic. "I'm going to try my luck. Whatever minister, rabbi, imam, give me what I want to hear." And he says, "Of all the righteous things that I do, which one is most pleasing in the sight of God?" And the mystic says, "It's when you take a nap in the afternoon." "Because at least in your sleep, you're not oppressing anyone." Now, think about how often there's a White House dinner and how every minister, rabbi, priest, and imam that I know would climb over their mother's back to get there as fast as possible. We don't need ministers or rabbis or imams to sanctify unjust policies. What is needed are people who will stand up and be the voice for the voiceless and to speak for the weak. They will do more than just say, "Not in my name," and "Not in the name of my tradition," but to say, "We speak for the ones who are too tired and hungry and powerless to speak for themselves. We do not grant you permission to bomb and maim and kill and sanction those who are already the poorest of the earth." Yes. The challenge for us is, are we willing to do what is morally and religiously right, even if it's not politically efficacious? Let me end with one of my favorite stories from the dear teacher, Martin. Again, if you read Martin at the end of his life, and
remember,
we all know that he's killed in Memphis. Do we remember why he went to Memphis? Well, the sanitation worker strike, when the city of Memphis refused to give them a cost of living adjustment. Right? And Martin gives that talk April 3rd, the night before he's killed. "If I were standing at the beginning of history and God had given me a panoramic view of time and had given me a choice of when to live," he says, "I would take a look at Socrates and Plato, Aristophanes, but I would not stay there. I would come to the time of Jesus, but I wouldn't stay there." He skips over Islam, which hurts my feelings, but that's fine. Nobody's perfect. "I would come to the age of Renaissance, and I would look at the magnificent contributions of humanity, but I would not stay there." I would even stop to see the man in whose honor I am named, Martin Luther, but I would not stay there. And I would come and see the founding fathers, but I wouldn't stay there. And I would come to see the president, Lincoln, and I wouldn't stay there. And I would just ask God to give me an opportunity to live in the middle part of the 20th century. And he says, he pauses for a second and goes, now that's an odd thing to say, because the world's messed up. But we recognize that when the sky is darkest is when you can see the stars. What I want to tell you is that if we had the choice of living in any period in history, I thank God for the gift of living now. This is not a naive, rosy kind of optimism. These are difficult days. These are days in which a lot of God's children are suffering. But I also believe that we are witnessing, maybe for the first time in our human history, the evolution of a new kind of awareness, where people here are concerned about the suffering of other human beings around the world to whom they're not related by anything other than being human. We care about people who are suffering in the floods of Pakistan, even if your skin color isn't the same as theirs, even if you're not of South Asian background, and even if your religion is different from them. That's a new thing for us humans, to not only feel empathy, sympathy, love, but to be moved to direct action. We may not live long enough, but because we have brought children into this world, we have a moral and a religious obligation to work to make it a better place. Martin, in that talk, the Riverside Church talk, ends with what I'm going to end with. I'm actually ending. I'll make a great preacher because I don't know how to shut up. He says, at one point, he offers a retelling of the Good Samaritan story, and we've all heard the Good Samaritan story, and we've heard it multiple times. And he tells it the familiar version that the priest walks by, and the Levite walks by, they don't stop to help the fallen person, why do they not walk by, and he offers some humorous explanations. Well, maybe they were going down to build the Road Improvement Association, and everybody chuckles because they know that that's not why. They don't stop because they're afraid. They're afraid that some robber may be hiding behind the rocks, and they may jump on them too. And then he ends by saying, but I tell you what my imagination is telling me. We have to reverse the question. We have to reverse the question and get to the point where instead of asking, if I help them, what will happen to me? We have to ask the question of, if I don't help them, what will happen to me? And he says, and the real fundamental question is not why did the person fall on this road and why did the Good Samaritan stop to help them? The real question that we have to answer is, why should we allow an edifice to exist which by its design produces victims? It's the entire system that is in need of transformation and redemption. This is the world that we have inherited. Time is morally neutral. Nothing will get better by itself. Nothing will get worse by itself. It will get better if we, as people of faith, put the love of God into direct action for the uplifting of the law of God's children. Let me stop there, if I may, and open it up for questions. And Franz, I think, is going to invite your questions. I know we got a lot of preachers in the audience, so I'm the only paid speaker today. So, you know, keep your questions so that they don't require semicolons and paragraph two.
Omida, I think you are the only speaker at a consortium conference who ever was interrupted by applause. There are two microphones. If you have questions, I will ask you to line up at the microphones if you are able. If you are not, just raise your hand very high so I can see it and somebody will bring the microphone to you. I will take questions alternatively from one and the other microphone. We invite everybody to ask questions. There are limitations as to time. If you can't take it under, keep it under 1 minute, please don't ask a question. It has to be relevant. And there was one other one, and I forgot what that was.
Yes, sir. I'm Doug Dorian. I'm from Spring Lake, Michigan, which is 25 miles from here. I felt like you were kind of speaking to the schoolroom here, the American people, let's say. But could you actually give the same speech in Iran and not be shot or not be, you know, whatever? I mean, it seems like it needs to go both ways. Can you speak to that?
Sure. Well, Iran is a place that actually has a very special place in my own heart. I'm a very proud American. My heritage is as an Iranian. So there's approximately 600 or so members of my family that are Iranians living in Iran. It's a place that I grew up. It's a place of my childhood, and it's a place that I continue to have many people that I care deeply about. Could I give the same talk in Iran? Sure. Could I not end up in a jail in Iran? I'm not so sure. I have a lot of friends who are activists in the Iranian reform movement, and I'm going to be talking about that tomorrow. At some point, the transformations in the public conversation about revolutionary politics in Iran. They have great sense of humor, and they say, we have perfect freedom of speech in Iran. We are free to say what we want to say, and the government's free to put us in jail. Part of their philosophy, their approach is, we're going to say what we want, and they're going to put us in jail, and there'll be 10 more people just like me. And at some point, they're going to run out of jail space. We're going to start publishing blogs. They're going to shut down one of them. We'll publish 10 more blogs. So is the Iranian government a standard of respect for freedom of speech? Absolutely not. Are there courageous and brave Iranians who are challenging that each and every day? Absolutely. More interestingly, as an American, should the United States live down to the repressive standard of Iran, Saudi Arabia, or China, why should we? We should set our standards in a way that honors the loftiest hopes and aspirations that we have, rather than saying, well, the Chinese have to crack down and torture people, why shouldn't we? Right? Let us be good.
I have a few questions, but one might.
Pick your favorite one.
I like your speech very much.
Can I interrupt for a second? Can I ask everyone also to mention your name very briefly when you ask your question? And I did forget to mention, we're allowed only one question for the time being, otherwise you have to go to the back of the line.
My name is Jake Prince. I like your talk very much. I agree with you, but you all said it by the United States. But I have a question. How many Muslim countries are there in the world who agree with you?
My mother doesn't agree with me. Why? Look, we have to get past the point where we expect one individual to represent an entire nation or an entire religion. I would never stand up here and say, I speak for all 300 million Americans, right? Because we're not a country like that. We're a 54%, 46% country on almost every significant issue that we agree and disagree about. There's no one Protestant figure that all of us would say, speaks for me. That's the one that all of us, Baptists and Methodists and Episcopalians, Catholic, Calvinists and Lutherans, we all agree that he speaks for us, right? I don't make any pretensions to being a superhero called Islam Man that somehow speaks for, I don't have a cape, I don't wear my underwear on top of my pants, and I don't wear spandex. I can't be tall buildings. I can't pretend to speak for 1.5 billion Muslims. What I can do, and what I do try to do, is to say that many of the issues that I have talked about, the concern for all of God's children, the concern for issues of social justice, that these issues resonate today all over the world. They resonate in this country, and they resonate in many Muslim countries. Do all people agree with it? Of course not, any more than they would agree with it here. But I think that every significant movement of change always begins as a minority.
In other words, you speak, you don't speak for the Quran, but you speak for your ideas.
It would take an incredible amount of arrogance for a person to say that I represent the weight of my scripture, none of it is mine, and I just have the mouthpiece for God. And I would hope that the humility that we spoke about in the beginning of this session would guide each of us in that particular light. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. The next question.
Alhamdulillah. I'm Cheryl. I was wondering, in this wonderful country where we have freedom of speech, why the spiritual leaders and those that have the gift to address the problems peacefully do not take the opportunity to do so on the media to address the scandalism that is so prolific. Can you tell me why they don't step up, those who have that gift, to do that?
Why they don't step up in the media? Why is it that those that have a more peaceful agenda don't step up in the media?
And they have the understanding, the leaders of the spiritual community.
Right. Well, I think it's a combination of factors. I'm not one who is particularly interested in assigning blame to particular people. I do think that members of all of our religious traditions at times have been much more interested in the status quo and in the maintenance of their institutional hierarchies and boundaries than they have been in the kind of transformative issues of justice that we're speaking about here. I also think that a certain amount of responsibility should be addressed to members of the corporate media. Much of our media is a sensationalist-driven process. So think about your local news. I'm staying in a room in this wonderful facility. I took two newspapers to my room last night. The first one was about Derek Jeter, and is this the end of the line for the great American icon? So this is like, you know, the headline news. The other paper that I read was from Grand Rapids, and as soon as I opened the page, it was a horrific, heart-wrenching story about someone who clearly is unworthy of the name father, but a dad who placed his knee upon the chest of his 2-year-old stepdaughter until she suffocated. Now, those kinds of stories are going to grab headlines. And they should. we should shine a spotlight so that these kinds of horrors can never happen. As a father, I also want to know, because I know some of you in the audience, how many of you got up at 6 o'clock in the morning and got your children dressed, dragging breath, and you brushed your teeth, made them cereal, took them to school, got yourself dressed so that you could come here? That's never going to make the headlines. A lot of our journalism is driven by an ethic that they call, if it bleeds, it bleeds. And I want to really question that, because journalism is not simply a mirror to society, it's also constructing a certain image as we go along. And I think by highlighting the evil, we're also helping foster and create it.
So how do you make good sensational?
I think good is sensational. I think love is real. I think justice is redemptive. And by talking about and highlighting the good work that people are doing, I think we can also draw people to it.
In the 70s and 80s, my work took me and my wife to many, many countries, including at least a dozen Islamic countries. We were always welcomed in every one by the local populace as Americans and as Christian. Today, that's gone. We are now known as the Great Satan. You have given us many ideas on how we can reverse that course. But how long is it going to take? Will my great-great-great-grandchildren have that opportunity?
Thank you. I don't claim to speak in terms of national wounds, but let's think in terms of interpersonal relationships, right? Many of us can think about situations where we were abused by a father, a mother, a step-parent, an uncle, a teacher, a priest, a rabbi, and people are wounded, and years down the road, you come to forgive and actually reclaim your sense of personhood through that act of forgiveness. You can think about, I am a teacher. I teach on a college campus. About a third of the women that I teach have experienced some kind of sexual assault. The overwhelming majority of those women, not that they forgive the person who assaulted them, but they come to establish meaningful relationships with men later on in their life. I would like to think that a similar process can work, but it's dependent on one of the first steps, which is a genuine and meaningful apology. We are sorry for the wrong that we committed against you. And we have learned from it, and here's how we want to have a different relationship. By the way, that is part of what I took to be the historic aspect of President Obama's speech last year in Cairo and in Turkey. Right? Can people around the world learn to forgive the United States? Sure. What will have to change are actions. They don't care about rhetoric. They want to know, are you still going to have 150 military bases in different countries around the world? Are you still going to produce more arms to destroy the world so many times? Are you still going to be involved in fighting wars here and there and there and there? Or are you going to transform yourself to being a meaningful part of a world community where when people think of America, they don't think first of our occupying armies, but they think of the charities that we do, of our ability to build schools and roads and hospitals. That would be my hope for how to actually and meaningfully transform people's impressions of the United States.
And the first step would be to get out and discuss things tomorrow.
All right. Thank you, sir. So my name is Emmanuel Joshua, and I'm basically from Pakistan. I just have two questions, if I'm permitted, one a bit of a theological one. So regarding this, what you said regarding that burning of the Quran, no doubt it is, I think, the most un-Christian thing which anybody would even think of, leave alone burning. But in that context, in my country, there have been numerous occasions where not scores but hundreds of Bibles have been burned churches have been desecrated, Christian girls have been publicly raped. Not a whimper from anybody in the Islamic world. This is on record. Even so much so that the Global Ministry of the United Methodist Church has taken up this case with the United Nations and with the U.S. Secretary of State. Anyway, that's a separate thing.
Thank you. Well, I appreciate your question. And let me say that I do remember from when I was here a few years ago, I believe you might have had a chance to come to that talk as well.
No, I didn't.
No, okay. But the issue of Pakistani and Saudi and African abuses of churches does come up. You're exactly right. We should be past the point where we say we expect the person to ask for the victimization of one community to speak here, but to be silent about it elsewhere. Part of what I hope for is that if we have people of good faith in different communities, in different countries, then we can operate by a simple standard. And the standard is simply this. We will stand up for what is just and what is morally right, regardless of whom it's happening to and who's the perpetrator. We don't care if it's my people who are victimized, my people who are the aggressors, or my people who are not even involved. We will simply speak up for God's children because they are God's children. And I think if we operated at that standard, then we could actually have a coalition of the willing that would take a consistent perspective about the case in Gainesville and about the cases in Pakistan. We wouldn't see these as competing and conflicting commitments, but actually as shared priorities.
Anyway, thank you very much. But sure. That has not been the case. Sir, one question. You spoke of love. You spoke of love. A very good point. Sir, my understanding of love, divine love, is that God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son, that he who should believe in him should have eternal life. And love your neighbor as yourself. I'm sure you must have. And love your enemies also.
Right.
So what is the equivalent in the Holy Quran for this?
Well, if Muslims believe that God so loved the world that he gave his own begotten Son so that anyone has faith in him, then we would be called Christians.
That is not the purpose of my question.
Well,
anything equivalent to that?
Yes, and I think if you are interested in it, I would be happy to recommend to you a vast body of literature. I have a wonderful short article that is called The Path of Love in Islam that's available online. You're more than welcome to study it. The important thing is not to ask, what is the Buddha in the Christian tradition? Or who is the Moses in the Hindu tradition? But actually, as students of humanity's religiosity, to approach every religious tradition in the terms that it has identified for itself. And I think at that level, we'll get to a much more fruitful way. But if you look up that article online, I think you might find some of your questions answered.
Thank you very much.
Sure. Hi.
Susan Gray is my name. A question that I think has to deal more with reactiveness in the culture and how to deal with it. You said two things that I was pleased, intrigued, and confused by. You said, how do you get past minimizing the evil that religion can do? Shedding a light on that. Sometimes when we shed the light, we can become reactive, as in the case with the pastor in Florida. And yet sometimes when we shed light, it's essential in case of the individual child who's abused. How do we learn when we are lifting up a negative that we must identify and care for, or when we're lifting up a reaction out of a reactionary tone that causes conflict? I think we really struggle with that. I teach sixth grade, and I want so much to help my students look for the marginalized and the oppressed, who in our culture on here are in the minority. But I do not want to create reactive adults.
Correct.
So what's your thought for us?
Going back to that lesson on humility, let's just take 10 seconds out of an answer to say that when we're dealing with something as serious as the trauma that a child experiences or the kind of wounds that a society is dealing with, that these are so deep and so subtle and so complex that we all know that no 15-second answer can possibly do justice to that. But let me try to answer it in this way. I spent some years of my life working with activists and theologians and thinkers in producing that book, the Progressive Muslims book that's out there. And a lot of it was a response not to American triumphalists, not to rabid pro-Israel people, but actually a response to people in my own community of Muslims. And understandably, it was a sense of wanting to insist that Islam can and should be a force for good, a force for justice, a force for healing of humanity. When you're dealing with the immediate after 9/11 period, naturally there was going to be some critique and reactiveness in the sense that you're talking about. There is a friend of mine who's a spiritual teacher from the Islamic tradition, someone that I hold just in the absolute highest of regards. He read the book very carefully, and we've been friends for 20 years. I called him and I said, "Oh, did you have a chance to read it? What did you think?" And he paused and he said, "I agree with everything that you say. I thought it was powerful. I also sensed that there was a lot of anger in what you wrote." He said, "The anger is understandable and the anger is justified. However, what I would love to see from you and from people like you would be," and this phrase has stuck with me for the last 7 years, "say what you have to say, do what you do, but do it in a way that is more beautiful, more compassionate, more gentle, and more generous. And that will be what will attract people to the vision that you have and the community that you want to build. Much more so than just criticizing less lovely perspectives." So I think we have to do both. There are times and places. And as a father, everybody has their pet peeves. One of mine is when you hurt a kid. Like, you know, I'm against death penalty, all forms of, you hurt a kid, you lost the right to be part of the human community. Sorry. Try again, better luck next time. Hope there's reincarnation. But the rest of the time, I think, rather than just spending one's life in these vicious cyclical arguments, do what is better, lovelier, more just, more gentle, more compassionate. Because I have faith in the ultimate goodness of God, and the ultimate goodness of God's children, I choose to believe that more people than not will respond to that.
My name is Joe Walker. I live in East Grand Rapids. I am a congenital Christian. And I want to find out if you would concur with an opinion that I've developed as a result of a number of experiences regarding social justice within my Christian denomination. And particularly, I'm going to cite two experiences I had. One was on vacation in Fort Lauderdale, and I went to a religious service and heard the pastor talk from the pulpit with a little braggadocio about how he solved the problem of homeless people who were sleeping on the lawn of his church buildings. And what he did was he got a hold of some fire ants and planted them in the grass, and that solved the problem. Well, after vacation, I came back to Grand Rapids, and the seasoned clergyman in my particular denomination, who was the head clergyman in the church I was going to, never spoke about social justice whatever. I'm very good on charity, which kind of reminded me of a prelate who once said, when I feed the poor, they call me a saint. When I ask why the poor are without food, they call me a communist. At any rate, I confronted him one day and said, how come you never preach social justice here? And this is a seasoned clergyman. I mean, I'm not talking about some neophyte just out of the freshly minted from a seminary. He said, well, if I were to preach that to my congregation, they would view it as, and he even put this in an email to me, they would view it as being liberal, radical, party political, and it would become financially dangerous to the building. So my question is, do you think that organized institutional religions are overly obsessed with the building or construction of buildings, maintenance of those buildings, symbolic art collections, that kind of stuff, and money, finances. Do you think that, that that's an obstacle to people who are trying to practice love, justice, and peace?
Thank you. Thank you for the question. I think the quick answer, of course, would be yes.
I guess that was a softball question.
Good afternoon, and thank you. My name is Suzanne Remus. I'm Jewish, and I'm an art teacher in the Latino section. And I had one of my 12-year-old students whispering to his neighbor, says to him, something about, and I heard him say something about Muslim. And I said to him, you know, I went over and I said, I want to know what you said to your neighbor. And he said, oh, I was talking about Muslims and how bad they are. And I said to him, I don't want you speaking about other people in this room. I don't want you talking about negative things, which mean not right things. And if I hear you talk and speak that way again, because there are other kids that heard it, I'm going to excuse you from this room. And he said, well, it's true. And I said, you don't know whether things are true or not. And I said to him, I will have to talk to the principal about this. Continue on with your work. So I want to ask you, how would you have handled that situation? I'm sure that that came from home.
Yeah. So a little personal story, I think, to go along with yours. No community has a monopoly on prejudice, just as no community has a monopoly on love and kindness. I've spoken a little bit about my wife, love of my life, beautiful, French, Canadian, Irish, German, when my father-in-law was alive, he passed away 2.5 years ago, he was an ardent Fox News watching, Rush listening, Republican voting, 40-foot American flag waving. When gas prices went up, he sold his little car and bought a pickup truck just to show people that, you know, I'm an American. And we would go to visit him, and I called him Dad. Be nice. Dad. It's like, Dad and I would sit there and watch Fox News. And I saw this as God's great test for me to spiritually cleanse myself, I think. And if you're familiar with Fox News, this will not come as any surprises. They were showing yet another one of their typical portrayals of Palestinians, which was not Palestinians in a refugee camp where they've been for the last 60 years. It was not unemployed Palestinians being bombed. It was a small footage of Palestinians dancing in the street post 9/11, right? And Dad saw that and said, cockroaches. hold on. And so I kind of thought if I should say something, and I was like, Dad, you know I'm one of them. And so are your grandchildren. And he said, no, 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 you're different. You're educated. You can't change everybody's heart. You can try. I'm a teacher. I can't make every student in the class get a subject. I'm not entirely persuaded that telling people don't use those words is the end of the conversation. Words are actions. Words create reality. So when we create a culture in which those words about Jews and Muslims and blacks and gays is acceptable, that does create a culture of hatred. Right? But what's really at stake is not what is in a person's tongue, but actually what is in their heart. And one of the hardest lessons that I think we have to learn is to actually come to realize that the different forms of prejudice are connected. That the underlying virus is the fear of the other. And it keeps finding new victims. So that 50 years ago, 20 years ago, its primary victims would have been blacks, Jews, the poor. Today, the primary victims are blacks, Jews, the poor, Hispanics, Muslims, gays and lesbians. Tomorrow, it will be blacks, Jews, Hispanics, Muslims, and somebody else. At some point, we have to address this question of otherness and to say, what is it that you fear about people that you don't even know? And how much do you know about the history, the culture, the literature, the tradition, the teachings of them? Much more importantly, do you know them as people? Much more interestingly, have you ever sat down and broken bread with them? Look, I love interfaith dialogue. I've been doing it for 25 years. Obviously, I like talking. More important than interfaith dialogue is interfaith action of people of good faith coming together to do something. I mean, that's actually like one of the amazing insights that groups like the Interfaith Action Network of Ibu Patel in Chicago and other places have done. That's, by the way that you get evangelicals and much more conservative people onto interfaith dialogue. They're never going to agree with you theologically, but they're going to come build a house for homeless families together. And then the next step is, can we really eat together? It's much harder to hit somebody that you've broken bread with. So I think what you did is the necessary first step. And I would love to see some of the future steps down the road that you and the student could take together.
Thank you. I'll let this to
this talk. Hi, I'm Maria Kelly. Okay. And actually, what you're talking about segues into my question. I was really captivated by the part of your speech where you talked about the more perfect union, that idea of it seems to break open a nice space because we spend so much time within our traditions and live within the traditions, and yet we have to look forward. So I guess my question is about the vision of the future when we have different traditions, and it seems to me there's a lack trust and understanding. So could you say more about this more perfect union and maybe about ways of articulating our visions better or ways of finding out where those places are beyond the interfaith dialogue system, which always includes people that are already interested in interfaith dialogue? Yeah.
Thank you. So I'm not here to bash interfaith dialogue. You understand? I am deeply committed person to to that whole process. And when I think about ways in which we're able to have Muslims and Jews and Christians having conversations like this, this wouldn't have happened without 30 years of initiative that people around these tables have created. So we are here because of a 30-year relationship. And where we want to be is dependent on how this relationship keeps nurturing and maturing as we go along. Nor am I somebody who advocates just criticizing the past and abandoning.
Yes. Okay.
I happen to think that all of our traditions, religious traditions, civic traditions, political traditions, have a lot to offer us. Let's say, for me as a Muslim, I look at the past 1,400 years of Islamic thought, something which I've spent 20 years studying, and I see an incredible reservoir of wisdom and compassion to live one's life in that same tradition. And a therapist I went to once said, every time you're about to say but or however, pause and ask yourself if it's really necessary, or if you say, you should say and. And whether the but and the however just undoes everything that you said before. So I'm trying to cut down the buts. And here's an interesting thing about the Quran. And it ties perfectly to that idea that Franz spoke about, and I was speaking about, the prophetic challenge of different prophets. No accident that people like Dr. King are so in love with the prophetic voice of the Hebrew Bible, Old Testament. Why Amos is one of his favorite books to quote. Let justice roll down the floor, it's not that. In the context of the Quran, when there's a group of people who use this excuse, we do such and such because we found our forefathers doing such and such, it's not the prophets who talk like that, and it is not the followers of the prophet who talks like that. It's the one that the prophets are sent to correct. Their excuse is tradition, to say, we're only carrying out the orders. We have the weight of precedence and tradition behind us. You're asking us to make all these changes. One of the things that I want us to think about in forming this more perfect union as a civic body and as religious communities is to do two things simultaneously. And I think we can, because this is why God's given us two eyes, two ears, two nostrils, but one heart. We can take the two and we can synthesize it into the one. With one eye, we have to keep an eye on our tradition. We have to study it, we have to master it, we can only reform what we have already mastered. And with the other eye, we have to constantly ask the question, does this particular teaching or practice uphold the dignity of all of God's children? I think that's the way to bring the best of our tradition and the best of what we have around us today and put it in action to try to foster this more perfect community in the future, inshallah. Thank you.
We have room for two more questions, especially because you've been so extremely patient people that have been standing there, I want to give them room.
My name is Odia, I come from Egypt. Thank you for the talk and for the sense of humor, which I think all of us enjoyed. My name is Wagia, I come from Egypt, and I thank you for the talk and for the sense of humor which I think all of us enjoy. If I understood you right, I think the version of Islam you're presenting today is the Sufi version, mystic Sufi version of Islam. You mentioned in particular Ibn Arabi. Ibn Arabi and other theologians of Islam or Sufi Islam spoke very well of the theme of love, the compassion, and all the great themes that are common between Christianity and Islam. The problem is, at least in the Arab world, Ibn Arabi, Jili, and others are not the ones who are raped. The ones who are raped in the Middle East are Ibn Taymiyyah. So the version we have in the Middle East, it's not the Sufi version of Islam. It's the Wahhabist version of Islam, the Sunni extremist Wahhabist version of Islam. So my question is there any way to reconcile the two versions of Islam, especially in regard to the rights of the Christian minorities in Islam?
Thank you. I'm in complete agreement with you that there are different interpretations of Islam, just as there are different interpretations of Christianity. And I wouldn't try to tell an audience like this of how Calvinists and Lutherans and Catholics and Greek Orthodox and Baptists and Methodists can and should agree or disagree. I may push you a little further and say that there's not, contrary to the book that Stephen Schwartz wrote, there are not just two faces of Islam, Sufis and Wahhabis, but actually a much broader spectrum of interpretations and practices. I'm also in agreement with you that a lot of the Wahhabi interpretations of Islam are a problem, a genuine problem, not only in terms of the rights of religious minorities, and not only in terms of the rights of Christians, but also in terms of the rights of other Muslims. Let's remember that the whole establishment of the Wahhabi school and its marriage to the Saudi royal family took place by extermination of a substantial number of Shi'i Muslims in places like Iraq and others, right? So people who tend to hate one group never stop at one. They oftentimes spread that hate, just like people would spread the love. I may disagree with you about how significant Ibn Taymiyyah is and has been historically. My sense is that people in the Middle East, in the Arab, the Persian, and the Turkish area, are reading a wide number of figures. Ibn Taymiyyah is one figure among the four Sunni schools of thought, and a fairly marginal school. So if you have the Shafi'i school, the Hanafi school, the Hanbali school, and Maliki school, it's the Shafi'i school and the Hanafi school that the overwhelming majority of Sunni Muslims belong to, which Ibn Taymiyyah did not. Ibn Taymiyyah is read today, and certainly if you read Sayyid Qutb and Ibn Ladmi and Zawahiri, you see many references to Ibn Taymiyyah. This is how, in their Quran writings, they tend to justify their actions. I don't think they even get Ibn Taymiyyah wrong, even though Ibn Taymiyyah is not my guy. But I happen to think they misread Ibn Taymiyyah in very important, very interesting kind of ways. The question for us is, how do we present these ideas for a more inclusive, pluralistic understanding of religion in societies which are oftentimes operating under immense political forms of repression? So let's take the Egyptian example. It's a little naive to think that the way to solve Egypt's problems is by just having a bunch of Sufi-loving Muslim intellectuals. It's hard for us to genuinely achieve that level of reform without also addressing the political repression that is today part and parcel of Egyptian society. And to ask that question is to then ask the question of why is it that Egypt is the second closest ally of the United States in the Middle East, and after Israel, the second largest recipient of US foreign aid. So they have issues to work out, and they should. We, in this country, are also partially responsible for propping up three of the most problematic societies in the region, Israel, Saudi Arabia, and Egypt. We have our issues as well, where in the name of political advantage, we have allied ourselves with societies that have atrocious violations of human rights. Thank you.
Last question.
Thank you. I'll have a statement, a question, and maybe a short answer. First, my name is...
I'll ask you to have a question also very short.
Yes, it will. my name is Gary Nearing. I'm a Christian, and we're all part of God's creation, all God's children. And I pray for Muslims, Jews, unbelievers, all, that they would become Christian. And it's part of my belief that salvation is found in Jesus Christ. And I want Muslims to be in heaven with me too, as Christians. So I have your well-being in mind.
As you see, absolutely. And my mother also wanted me to marry a nice Iranian girl. And at some point in time, she came to see that my happiness was more important than how she had come to imagine my happiness. It was a great step for my mother.
Well, on that note, I think we should end the... because we are running out of time.
Yes. Real quickly, though.
I'll give you
5 seconds.
Okay.
I just wanted to ask, you had mentioned about the pastor in Florida, threatening to burn the Quran. He didn't do it as far as I know. But you referred to him like as a hateful idiot and that type of people.
Ignorant pastor, I believe, was my technical reference.
Well, you're talking, about hateful idiots at that point, the Quran murder. But would you also classify like the Taliban and Al-Qaeda and the Wahhabi, fringe sects that are radical as hateful idiots or anything like that?
I keep going.
Yes, and many others,
Right.
But I would like the love of Christ to be for everybody, and it is, but yet,
sure.
We have these problems also.
All right, a very brief answer.
And the very brief answer would be, yes, I would agree with you that hatefulness and ignorance, just as love and charity, are human traits that are shared by all of us. And what I would probably push us to say is that what's required of us is more than simply saying we hate and condemn this interpretation of Islam, we hate and condemn that interpretation of Christianity or Judaism. Our responsibility is actually to offer something lovelier so that we can actually take part, not only in making ourselves and our religion look good, but actually in offering a more viable alternative for people. And I would hope that many of us would find an opportunity to join together in that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Before we eat together, I have 3 short announcements. First of all, if you are on the waiting list for lunch, and we have 30 extra lunches available, please see Heidi Stuckey at the registration desk to pay for those. The second is that if you need a quiet room for prayer, on the 3rd floor, which is back into the conference center, behind the breakfast area upstairs, you will find a quiet space for that. And finally, here's how we're going to do the lunch buffet. You will go outside these rooms, on the outside of the couches, and eventually come through the middle where there is the food, and you can come back through the middle back into this room. And make sure to show your lunch tickets at the students who will collect them there. And I would say, let us break bread together.